Good morning. Happy Sabbath to you. I'll be looking forward to the time where we get back to our normal services. See a piano player walking up here, so just a couple of announcements. Tomorrow, tomorrow is a work bee. There's going to be some folks around at 8 o'clock at the new building. If you'd like to join us, practice your safe social distancing and what you can to do, what you can to do some of the things we need done. There's some chairs that need some washing that we'll be sitting on here in just 2 or 3 weeks. So those, and then there's a few other things. There's some boxes that we can haul from this building to the other one for some storage in the meantime. But there will be a list of things to keep us busy. And then also a business meeting that evening at 5 o'clock. And that will be at the new building, the business meeting. And we will be looking at some finalizations of some plans that we're going to give the architect so we can get that ball rolling. The closing of this church, as far as with the new purchasers, will be either the 17th or the 24th. But we can be here on the 25th, and I want you to show up for that. There will be some baptisms going on that day. We have three of those happening. Also, you'll want to attend. Pastor Marvin will be here. He'll be traveling down. He'll get in town the 22nd. And then he'll be preaching here before he and I head up to camp meeting the following day. So there's several things going on. If we would like to... Rachel, I hope I know all these. Hymn number 554, Let Me Walk With Thee. I'm fairly certain I know that one. 554.
Oh,
this time, let's just bow our heads for a word of prayer. And we'll start our service, and then we'll ask for some prayer requests for the praise and share time. We'll sing another song. Kind and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for an opportunity to be here to worship you. We thank you so much for the sunshine, the warm weather. We thank you for our church family. We thank you for safety and security that we can find in you. And as we attempt to walk with you today, we ask that your Holy Spirit join us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Are there any prayer requests at this time that we would like to share as a church family? Yes, there's one here and one there.
I'd like us to pray for President Trump and his staff and children. What God wants him to do with this country.
Okay. Pray for our president and his staff and all the leaders. It seems like our nation has lost its way, and especially in these interesting times that we're living in. So we need to pray for our leadership every single day. Yes?
I have a new great-granddaughter as of Thursday.
Oh, praise God.
Pray prayers for her well-being.
Amen. Your great-granddaughter. Yes.
My chicken was in the hospital again, and I'm trying to figure out why. And God showed me why I was in the hospital when I received a possible thing where they need to do a sleep study on me so that I can literally diagnose just exactly what's going on. I throw up every day, and it's been such a trauma and a turmoil with me doing that because it makes my throat sore. And so I need extra help and prayer for health and getting lots of sleep and rest and sunshine and eating right and not eating beef. I literally want to do that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All
right. Pray for Randall and then Elaine and then Jennifer.
I'm back for my granddaughter and my grandson for healing. And then I have a brother-in-law die on Wednesday and I'd like prayer for his family.
Okay. I'm praying for the upcoming school year and then all the students who need to be there will be there.
Yes. Your new baby sister? Yes. Congratulations, by the way.
Congratulations.
All right. Well, once again, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer as we lift these in the church family and in the church situation as we go forward. Kind and loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the many, many blessings that you've given us. You have heard our petitions from healing to praise, to thank you for guidance with our nation's leadership. We think of a church family that will be in flux here as we move across town and learning a new building and new things. We have a new associate pastor coming to this area and a newly formed district. Pray for that. Lord, this world is mixed up and turned upside down, and in the midst of it, we need to be a calm in the storm. And we pray that as followers of your Son, that we might reflect to this community a loving Savior who is coming soon. And Lord, be with us in this trying time. Be with me as I preach a message here in just a little bit from the 23rd Psalm, that the words I use might be yours. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing hymn number 537. 537, He Leadeth Me. we'll stand for that. Hymn number 537, "He Leadeth Me." Back here if you'd like, and remember There are some communities that are devastated by the pandemic, and but just right on their COVID-19 response or pandemic response on the tithe envelope, and it'll get to where it needs to go. It'll provide different things, whatever it takes, from supplies to masks to counseling, different things like that for different communities that are in need.
Amen.
And so we want to remember that. And also take note in your bulletin, the first reading of a membership transfer for Bob and Michelle to move their membership here. That'll be a blessing when that's done. Amen.
Bob and Michelle, who?
Who?
Thank you.
Goodbye. All right, are there any announcements that I should have made that I'm missing before I begin? All right. Well, if you're happy to be in God's house today, say amen.
Amen.
I'm glad it's Sabbath. Mm-hmm. There's been several folks working over at the new building trying to get things semblance of going. We've been transferring some of the materials downstairs over to the new building. And although the work is exhausting, it's rewarding. And I want to thank those of you who have had the privilege, either on this side of things or that side of things, or on this side of things, been helping with that. It's been making it nice. A message that I wanted to share with you today, I've entitled Walking Through the Shadows and How to Find Comfort in a Time of Fear. There's no denying that our world is living in fear right now.
Absolutely.
There's not a week now that goes by that I don't speak with somebody that is just afraid. And some of the fears is speaking to that their world is never going to be the same again. They want to get back to normal, but what is the new normal? And I have to admit that I don't think that this world will go back to the way it was before this pandemic and the response to it. And so if you want to put your finger in the 23rd Psalm, we will be there for a while and you can refer to it. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version, Psalms 23. It's a very short psalm, 26 verses long. And this is familiar to most people. Randall and I were trying to, in my car here a few weeks ago, we're trying to recite this and paying attention to traffic and multitasking wasn't the easiest thing for us to do, and we thought we had forgotten one line or two.
Yes, we did.
I think we might have gotten it all, but we might have gotten it out of order. But here it is in order. Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. You can say it along with me if you'd like. It's on the screen there, the version I'm reading. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Here this psalm has brought comfort to many, many people at many, many different times in their life. I have read this psalm on the deathbed, in a hospital, in a nursing home, in people's homes. I have read this over the phone with people who were dealing with different kinds of trauma. I have read it myself in the privacy of my own devotional time and contemplated these things. I was thinking the other day, when I was in academy, it was a project of the school newspaper. They had, I think, three different contributors, student contributors, and they paraphrased this psalm. And I remember one of the passages, the very first verse. They said that the Lord cares for me. I won't have any need of anything. And I thought that was very good. The Lord cares for me, and that's the picture that we get of a shepherd. Martin Luther once commented that faith is a matter of personal pronouns. And what he was talking about is that it's one thing to say that the Lord is a shepherd, but it's a whole other thing to say that the Lord is my shepherd. Amen?
Amen.
And so Jesus just isn't a shepherd. God just isn't a shepherd out there. He is my shepherd. And so our faith is wrapped up and bound in that idea, that imagery, that God, that Jesus is our shepherd. I'm the sheep and He is the shepherd. And so that image of a shepherd, it provides us with many positive thoughts. If we would just think about an image of a shepherd maybe back in Jesus' day. The word itself carries with it thoughts of tenderness, thoughts of security, thoughts of provision for those that are being shepherded. And whether one's a Christian or not, the 23rd Psalm has been a source of comfort for so many people over the ages during the dark times, during the times of trouble, during times of pain, during times of calamity, and during times of heartache. You know, I think that this is one of the reasons that this psalm was written. It was written in a very dark time in David's life that he needed to remind himself that God was still with him. Have you ever been needed to be reminded that God is with you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're anything like me, from time to time you wonder, where are you, God? But I'm glad that David wrote this psalm in a dark time because he pronounced and proclaimed that God was with him. He was living in exile and he was running for his life from his own son, Absalom, who wanted to kill him and take his throne. So you and I can take comfort once again in reminding ourselves of our shepherd's great care for us. It's an incredible joy for us to know that if God is with us in the shadows of death, He will certainly be with us even in the shade of adversity. Amen?
Yeah.
I find myself frustrated watching the news, especially with this COVID thing going on, and then also all the different violence and riots, and just our world is being turned upside down. And you just wonder where things are going. And so we know what adversity is. Some people are out of work because of what's going on. Some people are afraid to leave their homes because of what's going on. And it's a joy to know that God is with us. If He's with us in the shadows of death, He can be with us in the shade of adversity. The psalmist is quick to point out that God leads in this psalm. He restores, He guides us with His rod and His staff. Pictured up here is the staff, I believe. The rod was like a small baseball bat, however. He had two, the shepherd would carry two things with him. This little rod that he would take. And it's what the shepherds used as a weapon to ward off criminals, you know, like a bully club or something. And wild animals that posed a threat to the sheep, but also the staff, which was the longer one that he could use. It had a hook on the end so he could catch or grab hold of the sheep and stop them when they were nearing danger or heading in the wrong direction. And so our God carries a rod. You know, my Bible tells me that he will rule the nations with a rod of iron. So there's some shepherd imagery there. But he also carries a staff to keep me going in the right direction and grabbing hold of me when I am about to enter into some danger. This imagery of the shepherd written by David was to show us that of God's constant vigilance towards us. It's his personal presence and his personal involvement in the lives of those who are his sheep. How many of you appreciate the fact that God is like a shepherd and he's actually involved in what you're doing?
Right here.
Amen. One of the greatest blessings of the 23rd Psalm is knowing that we will never find ourselves in a situation where the Lord is not aware of our troubles and our difficulties. In fact, in Hebrews 13:5, we're assured by God's own promise that I will never fail you, I will never forsake you. That's a good promise. Amen. God is there with us, and it's his promise that we can be assured of. And that 23rd Psalm is just a good reminder, and I would encourage you this afternoon, this week, if you're feeling that God is not near, read that Psalm and see that God is actually near. You know, that's why we can say with confidence in this next verse, verse 6, that the Lord is my helper, so I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?
That's right.
You know, even though things are rough, even though things are tough, even though times are difficult, even though there's adversity at every hand, we can proclaim that the Lord is my helper, so I will not be afraid. Just because troublous times are here does not mean that we have to fear. We can take the good news with us today by simply reminding ourselves that God is with us even when we're walking through the shadows. Amen? Even when it seems that God is not there, we can remind ourselves, we can take that good news with us. You know, as we walk through the shadows, many of us have walked through those shadows. And the Hebrew imagery here, it's speaking to times of darkness. In fact, when he's painting the picture of that psalm, it's like it's total darkness, where you don't know how you're going to get to the other side. The other day, Robert and I were up at the church, the new building, and we were moving some furniture around, and we're trying to conserve a little bit of energy, so we had the lights off in one of the big rooms there, and we were moving a piece of furniture or shelf or something, and Robert said it'd be a good idea if we turned the lights on so we could see where we were going. It was like we were in total darkness. It took time for our eyes to adjust, but when we turned the light on, everything was fine. Many of us have been there. The boss says, clean out your desk, or we're going to have to let you go. These times of total darkness. Maybe the police officer at the door tells you there's been an accident. or the doctor tells you your child will have some birth defects, or your disease is terminal. Maybe when the principal calls and says your son has been expelled, or your daughter is having difficulties at school. Dark times when a spouse says, I've had enough, I want a divorce. You know, the same was true for the sheep of David's flock. The sheep frequently had to go through the darkest part of the valley, the lowest part where the sun did not shine, in order to get to greener pastures. But they had to trust the shepherd whose presence trumped all their fears, whose presence trumped their temptation to just cut out, to scatter, to run off in a state of panic. It involved trust. This dark shadow of the valley that represents the death, the threat of death, it portrays the other side of reality, that life doesn't always go the way I planned it. Have you felt that from time to time, that life doesn't go as you planned? That's almost every day. Sometimes things don't go well, and that dark shadow of the valley, it represents that. The pastures are sometimes black and barren instead of green. The waters are sometimes deep and torrential instead of peaceful and still. But regardless of what type of situation David found himself, he knew that God was with him through it all. Does that bring you comfort this morning? David, when he was in times of darkness, he knew that God was with him through it all. And so you and I, as we read through the 23rd Psalm, we can say that God is there for me too. Well, how do we know that God was with him? Look at your Bible once again there in the 23rd Psalm. And I want you to notice something. We know that God was with him because he talked directly to God in the shadow of the valley. Look at the grammar in this scripture, in this psalm. All the time David had been speaking of God in the third person. He makes me lie down. He leads me. He will restore. He, you know, we see this third person. But when David gets down into the darkness of the shadow of the valley of death, he changes to the second person by saying, you are with me. It's like telling somebody about God, and then that's the difference between you telling somebody about God and you speaking to God. In the darkest part of David's life, he says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Mm-hmm. Have you ever tried to encourage somebody in saying that, oh, he's with you? It's trying to, you're trying to say that out of experience, I can tell you that he's with you. But they have to experience them for themselves. And so that peace, that comfort that David felt when he was in the darkest time, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of the death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. Mm-hmm. Although it's not in the text, the best way to know that God was there is because of the shadow. If I asked you, if everything was dark, there is no shadows, but what makes or what casts a shadow?
Light.
There are no shadows without light.
That's right.
Though it's not in the text, that we can see it there. What needs to be present in order for a shadow to be cast is light. God is our light, amen?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is our light. And it's through the presence of His Son, Jesus Christ, the Shepherd. This light was David's comfort when he walked in the shadows. The shadows are just shadows that are cast by the light. And so David knew there was light. And that's the light that comforted him. Look in Exodus chapter 33. It's the promise that Moses took with him into the wilderness, where it says there in Exodus 33:14, my presence will what? My presence will what? Will go with you, watch over you, wherever you may go. You see, it just wasn't for David, and it just wasn't for Moses, was it? It was for Jacob. God made the same promise to Jacob in Genesis 28:15. He says, I am with you and will watch over you wherever you may go. Also to Joshua in Joshua 1:5, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. In Isaiah 41 and 43 there, it says, do not fear, don't be afraid, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. When you pass through the waters, what? I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. God doesn't keep us from the waves. God doesn't keep us from the blaze. He doesn't keep us from the shadows. He goes through them, goes with us through them. Amen?
Amen.
We also have many, many more promises. I'll leave you with this one. Jesus made a promise to us. He says in Matthew 28:20, surely. What does it mean when somebody says surely?
You better do it.
You can count on this. For sure. It's His promise to you and to me. Surely I am with you always, even to the very end of the age. And we can hold on to that promise, amen? And when we look in our Bible at the 23rd Psalm, as we contemplate our own life, as we walk through the shadows, the valley of death. You know, I think there's a reason that it is so popular with people. This was a psalm that was written about, it's one of the messianic psalms, and it's talking about Jesus being in the grave. If you can see that imagery there, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Jesus drew comfort from that. As the ancient Israelites would sing their these psalms of praise to God, and they worked through the the times in Christ's life that was to come, the Messiah that was to come. And David, when he was going through his own life, it was also about the Messiah, and he would have hard times. So we have a high priest that can sympathize with us. That's what we have in Jesus Christ. So we have somebody that's been through the dark places. He's been through the valley of the shadow of death. And yet was not afraid. And so he can legitimately share that promise with us, that surely I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. So we can hold on to that promise, especially in the age that we're living in now. Amen?
Amen.
Let's close with another hymn. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Hymn number 545. Savior, like a shepherd. Thank you, Rachel.
What was it?
545. Think of the words of the 23rd Psalm as we're singing these words. Take us with that comfort to our homes. May we be blessed by the Sabbath rest that you've provided. We look forward to a time when we can linger in fellowship. But until then, Lord, keep us. Thine we are. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
You are dismissed.